What up, beautiful people? It's your boy Mundus. Welcome to the Shine Life family. This is going to be an important video, the most important video you'll watch for a very long time. We're talking about end time Christianity, the mark of the beast, the vaccines. What does this all mean? And this is such an important topic. I've not done one of these videos for a long time. I mean, I do have a video, a series on end times, but new information I've received new information. Pastor Chris, a man of God, has been sharing with us from your Love Word special about the end times, about the book of Revelation. And he revealed such an important truth. And I don't know if a lot of people got that. I want to share that truth here. But before that, I want to talk about something so important. So if this is going to be one of those long videos, so make sure you go grab a coffee, grab a tea. This is going to bless you tremendously. This is going to bless you tremendously and reveal, show you what is going on around the world. What is your role as a Christian? What does this all mean? And how can you get ready? So let's get into it. So as I was thinking about this topic, the other day I was just thinking about it. I was just thinking, dear Holy Spirit, the Spirit of God reminded me of something. You know, back in the Old Testament, not in the Old Testament. Yeah, back in the days of Jesus, you know, the Pharisees, they were known as the doctors of the law. They knew the law so well. They knew the books of Moses. They prided themselves to know the scriptures more than anyone else, right? That was that generation of the Pharisees. I want you to picture this in your mind. You know, we're talking about, I want to deal with that first topic, end time Christians. So I want to bring this in your mind. So the days of Jesus walking the streets of Galilee, you have the Pharisees, very vast in the laws of Moses, in the books of Moses. They know all the law. They knew about the Messiah. They knew at one point the Messiah will come. But guess what? Did it even cross their minds? The Messiah will show up in their generation. They read the books of Moses. They read about Isaiah, Jeremiah, the prophet. They read about the Psalms, about all these prophecies and predictions of the Messiah coming. But never in a split second did they ever thought it will be in their generation. It's like you reading the scriptures, you're reading, yes, the Messiah is coming. Yes, we know the Messiah will come. It was something that was futuristic. It was futuristic to them. They never thought for a second, could the Messiah be here now? Could this be the time? They never even knew about the timings. They read about it like something that's going to happen. Yes, Messiah will come. Things will be fine in Israel. He will restore the kingdom, all that. They never knew the timings of the Messiah. They never knew when was he supposed to come. But they prided themselves to know the scriptures. I want to show you. I want you to bear that in mind. This is so important. Let's look at the scriptures real quick right here. Let us look at, I took some notes. I'm going to share with you. This is going to be a very, very, very interesting time. So we look in the book of John, chapter 5, verse number 2. Let's look at this. Let me highlight this. These are the words of Jesus. We're talking about end time Christianity, right? So Jesus says, let me start from verse 38. He says, and you have not known, he's talking to the Pharisees, and you have not known, you have not his word abiding in you, for whom he has sent, him you believe not. This is Jesus telling them, man. He says, search the scriptures, for in them ye think ye have eternal life, and they are they which testify of me, and ye will not come to me that ye may have life. So he was saying, you pride yourselves to know the scriptures, but you don't understand. These scriptures are the ones that testify of the Messiah, testify of me. Jesus was saying, I am that Messiah that you hoped for. I'm the Messiah that you read about in the scriptures. You read about in Moses. You read about in Psalms. I am here now. I'm here now. This is not futuristic. It's not going to happen in the bastard. So the Pharisees' generation, the Israel generation, that was the generation of the Messiah. That was the generations of the first coming. And like our generation, You know, a lot of people, you talk to them about, oh yeah, this is the end time. Yeah, everybody talked about the end times. Yeah, the world will come to an end. Yeah, the world will come to an end in the future. They have this futuristic idea of the second coming of Christ. Like it's going to be somewhere in the future. Yeah, it can't happen in our generation. I want to remind you, the Pharisees, they thought the same way too. They thought the same way too. I'm going to show you another scripture. Let's go to the book, still same book of John, chapter 7. And let's look at verse number 40. So this is Jesus speaking. I mean, he was preaching everywhere. People are believing in him everywhere. Everyone's excited about it. Everyone's believing. So verse 40 says, And many of the people therefore, when they heard this saying, said of the truth, this is the prophet. Let's read what the saying he said. Jesus, when he talked about, he that believeth on me, as the scriptures have said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. He said, this is speak of the Holy Spirit, the ones that will believe in him will receive. But Jesus was speaking like this. And he says, many of the people therefore, when they heard this saying, said of a truth, this is the prophet. They said, some were like, no, this is the Messiah. This is him. Verse 41. Others said, some say this is the prophet. Others said, this is the Christ. So it was a division of people were saying, this is the prophet. Others said, this is the Christ. But some said, look at this. But some said, shall Christ come out of Galilee? Hath not the scripture said that Christ cometh out of the seed of David, out of the town of Bethlehem, where David was? So there was a division among the people because of him. And some of them would have taken him, but no man laid hands on him. Before I keep on reading, it's the same way right now. You have a lot of divisions among Christians. Some Christians are like, yes, we have read the scriptures. These are the days of revelation. Others are like, oh no, you don't, the fear mongering. Don't be scaring people about the rapture. No, let's now go focus about the rapture and the antichrist. This is not happening. So people are thinking, these are not the end times. Others are saying, no, it's not it. It's not going to happen. The vaccine is not the mark of the beast. This is not, divisions. Like when Jesus came the first time, they had it. Others were like, he's a prophet. I was like, no, he's not a prophet. This is the Messiah. This is the Christ. I was like, nah, he's not the one. Because when I look at the scripture, it's saying the Messiah should come from, they said, can the Messiah come out of Galilee? Shall Christ come out of Galilee? The same things that's happening today. People are looking at the book of Revelations and saying, no, that's not what it means in the book of Revelations. It does not mean that, because it says the mark of the beast will be right in your hand and then your forehead, and then it says that this time we're going to address all those things. But I want to let you know the mindset. When Jesus came the first time, these were the same arguments, the same ideas of arguments. Is he the one? Is this the time? Is it not the time? Could this be the time? Is it not the time? Maybe it's the time. So anyway, then came officers to the chief priests and the Pharisees, and they said unto them, why have you not brought him? Because the Pharisees sent the officers to go arrest Jesus, to bring him here. The officer said, The officer answered, never man speak like this, meaning no man has ever spoken like this. Then answered them the Pharisees, are you also deceived? Have all the rulers or all the Pharisees believed on him? So look at the Pharisees. They say, what's wrong with you? Are you guys deceived? Do you believe in him now? Do you think he's the Christ? He says, look at us. Do you think we have believed on him? But they say, and they keep on saying, but these people who knoweth not the law are cursed. These are the words of the Pharisees. Nicodemus said unto them, he that came to Jesus by night, being one of them, doth our law judge any man before it hear him and know what he doeth? Then answered and said unto him, art thou also of Galilee? Search and look, for out of Galilee arises no prophet. And every man went to his own house. So they were debating, like, no way, the Messiah is not coming from Galilee. This is not the time. They are deceived. Like, some people are very adamant right now. One second. Yeah, like Some people are very adamant right now. These are not the last days. This is fear-mongering. The vaccine is not the mark of the beast. It's about, we're just trying to deal with a pandemic. No, there's nothing wrong with it. You people should take it. Christians should take it. I've actually heard, not going to mention names, Christians, well-respected men of God, telling their people, no, don't worry about it. Take the mark. Take the vaccine. It's okay. You'll be all right. It's fine. It's for God wants you to take the vaccine. So it's like, it reminds me of the Pharisees. They're saying, well, why are you believing that nonsense about the end times? Why are you believing in that nonsense about the vaccine being a mark of the beast? Why are you believing in nonsense that the world, the rapture is soon? No, why are you believing that? See that no prophet will come from Galilee. Go make sure. People, that the doctrine of the rapture is a delusional doctrine. It's not going to happen. This is not the generation. It's not happening. But the king was there already. The Messiah was there already. It was their generation that will see Jesus. It was their generation that will see, they will see the Messiah. They didn't notice. And they were looking and say, go look in the scripture. It's not him. They didn't know. It was them. It was their generation. Like a lot of Christians don't realize, we are that last generations. Whether you like it or not, you know, a lot of people feel, they will feel like it's a sense of dread. I'd rather not deal with that issue. But we are this generation. We are this last generation. The signs are very evident. Like it was evident for them right then. The signs are very evident everywhere. Let me look at my notes actually. I had a couple things in my notes that I want to talk about. I want to share with you, let's see, the story. We're talking about the sign. I want to share the story of a blind man. I want to read to you a story. I'm talking about, the evidence is very evident. Jesus said, I foretold you of all these things so that you can know when it happens. The signs are evident. You have to be blind to miss the signs. You have to be blind not to be aware these are that times. You have to be blind not to be aware we are that last generation. We are that end time Christians. We are the last. I want to read to you this. This is so important. It's going to be a little bit of a read. So John chapter 9, verse 1. It says, and as Jesus passed by, he saw a man which was blind from his birth. And his disciples asked him, saying, Master, who did sin, this man or his parents, as he was born blind? They said, neither had this man seen nor his parents, but the works of God should be made manifest. So anyway, he said, I must work the works of him that sent me while he's dead. Anyway, what he did, let me read how he healed the man. And he healed the man. When he had spoken, he spat on the ground, made clay on the clay of the spittle. He anointed the eyes of the blind man with clay, and said unto him, go wash in the pool of Siloam, which is interpreted sent. He went his way therefore, and washed, and came seeing. Jesus opened a blind man's eyes, who was born blind. He was born blind from birth. He never seen in his life. He opened his eyes. He gave him new eyes. The neighbors thereof, look at this, is important. This, he never washed, he never saw in his life. He was blind from birth. The neighbors therefore, and they which before had seen him that was he was blind, said, is it not this that he sat and begged? They're saying, is it not the same dude that was, we know that is blind? Some said, this is he. Others said, he's like him. But he said, I'm the one. He heard them talking and said, what are you talking about? I'm the dude that got healed. I am him. Therefore said they unto him, how were thy eyes opened? He answered, said, a man that is called Jesus made clay, anointed my eyes, and said unto me, go to the pool of Siloam and washed. And I went and washed, and I received my sight. Then said they unto him, where is he? He said, I don't know. I know not. They brought him to the Pharisees. This is key. This is important. So Jesus does a miracle, performs a miracle. The blind man, born blind, can see. They brought to the Pharisees him that aforetime was blind. It was the Sabbath day when Jesus made the clay and opened his eyes. Then again, the Pharisees also asked him how he had received his sight. He said unto them, he put clay upon my eyes, I washed, and I do see. this is a miracle. I want you to know this. This was a miracle. He's telling them, the Pharisees, about this miracle that took place. Therefore said some of the Pharisees, this man is not of God, because he keepeth not the Sabbath. Oh Lord. He healed someone that was born blind. But they don't straight away go like, oh, praise God for this miracle. They straight away go like, no, this is not of God. How come he healed him on the Sabbath? Others said, how can a man that is a sinner do such miracles? And there was division among them. I want to bring this to you. There are so many signs. People are like, the scriptures talk about how come this vaccine is closely resembling Revelation 13 about the mark on your hand. How come it's going close there? And the town of mandate, you can't enter shops unless you have the mask, or you can now fly unless you prove you've been vaccinated. How come this is quite similar with what we're reading in Revelation? These are signs. And for people will be like, nah, it's not it. Don't worry about it. The mark of the beast. You know, when the mark of the beast happens, they will tell you this is the mark of the beast before they give it to you. People are, this is how they think. This is the mark of the beast. Now take the mark of the beast. We will be very aware this is the mark of the beast. And they will tell us this is the mark of the beast. So this division, people are now reading the signs. Like this man, it was obvious he's been healed. He was blind. He can see. But the obvious sign, can you imagine? Oh man, this is amazing. He was blind. Very obvious blind. And I'm getting ahead of myself. They say unto the blind man again, what says thou of him? He that opened thy eyes. He said, he's a prophet. So the blind man said, he's a prophet. But the Jews did not believe concerning him that he had been blind and received his sight. So they were like doubting. It's like, nah, this dude, he's lying. This dude is lying. He says, go call his parents. Go call. This is not, he was definitely not born blind. It's impossible. No, he's lying. He's making this up. He's just trying to say this guy's a prophet. Go call his parents. Until they called the parents of him that received the sight. And they asked them, saying, is this your son whom you say was born blind? Is this for real? Is this your son that was born blind? How then does he now see? His parents answered them and said, we know this is our son. And he was born blind. He said, yes, this is our son. He was born blind. But by what means he now see, we know not. Or who has opened his eyes? We know not. He's of age. Ask him. He shall speak of himself. He said, he's a grown up. He can talk to himself. Can you believe the sign was very obvious to the Pharisees? A blind man seeing. This was proof positive. This was the Messiah. Jesus said, if I testify on myself, you might call my witness false. He says, if you don't believe me for the work's sake. He says, the works that I do, that I don't do by my own. He says, if you don't believe me, believe the works. A man that was born blind and is seen, they didn't want to believe it. They did not. It was an obvious sign, but they refused to believe it. Like right now, the signs are so obvious. We are heading towards the end time. We are heading towards this new world order, this beast system. It is very obvious. You literally have to just close your eyes and say, la, 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 it's not happening. It's not real. It's not real. It's very obvious. And yet, like the Pharisees, a lot of people are still like that. It was obvious this person was healed, but they refused to believe this. These words, I'm reading verse 22. These words spake his parents because they feared the Jews, for the Jews had this is key, for the Jews had agreed already that if any man did confess that he was Christ, he should be put out of the synagogue. So a lot of people don't want to lose their associations. You have a lot of Christian ministers, because they're so much in cahoots with the government, or so tied in. They don't want to say the wrong narrative. They don't want to speak against the vaccines because they don't want to lose out of maybe of that government funding, of that government assistance, because no, we need to be politically correct. No, you know, and a lot of people are even taking stance. It's like, oh, if you want to take the vaccine, pray about it. Let God guide your decision. let me save you your effort praying. I know I'm getting ahead of myself. This is not of God. No Christian or anybody should take this vaccine. There's no prayer needed. There's no specific, I want to get specific counsel. The counsel is, do not take this vaccine. But we have a lot of ministers. Thank God for a man of God, Pastor Chris, because He was the lone range voice when everyone else was silent. He was bold enough, not wishy-washy, not trying to be politically correct. He came out and gave the full counsel of God. And that's what a man of God should do. He gave the full counsel of God, not trying to appease man, not trying to be politically correct. You straight up come and give the counsel of God. And that's what he did. And he empowered everyone around the world. Everyone's faith was built. Because that's what a man of God does. We look up to the man of God with the word of God. What thus says the Lord? Back in the old time, it used to be like, things will go wrong. They say, go call the prophet. What thus says the Lord? What is God saying about this? And the prophet will give the word of God. And our modern day prophets are not saying anything. But thank God for a man of God. He's giving the word of God. He's saying, no, this is not it. Don't take it. It's not like, Lord, let me pray about it. No, don't take it. Point blank, period. Do not. Absolutely do not. But anyway, I want you to read that. It says, the parents feared the Jews because they didn't want to be thrown away from the synagogue. If any man did confess that he was the Christ. Look at the word. I want to highlight that. It says, this word speak his parents. Because they feared the Jews, for the Jews had already agreed that if any man did confess that he was the Christ, he should be put out of the synagogue. So they knew a lot of people were believing this is the Messiah. But they say, you know what? If anyone says it, you're not going to come to the synagogue. If you say don't take the vaccine, we're going to ban your accounts from the social media. If you tell your congregation to not take the vaccine, we are going to cut off the funding. So it's nothing new. But we have, thank God, that's what, like I'm saying, thank God for man of God, Pastor Chris. You have bold men of God that are standing their ground, unafraid, unapologetic, ready to speak the word of God. What thus says the Lord. So yeah, it's simply amazing. Therefore said his parents, he's of age, ask him. Then again, so the Pharisees, they have refused to recognize the sign. Then again called they, I'm reading verse 24. Then again called they. They said, then again called they the man that was blind and said unto him, give God the praise. We know this man is a sinner. Oh Lord. They wanted so much to believe he was not the Christ. They didn't want to believe he was the Christ. They refused it. He says, you praise God, not him. He's not the Christ. He answered and said, whether he be a sinner or no, I know not. One thing I know, that where I was blind, now I see. Oh Lord, glory be to God. And they said, then said they to him again, this is King James, by the way. English is a little bit. What did he do to you, basically? How opened he his eyes? He answered them, I have told you already. You did not hear? Wherefore would you hear it again? Will you also be his disciples? At this point, the blind man is frustrated. He's like, what's wrong with you? I've already told you what he did. I've already told you, open my eyes. You don't want to believe? Then they reviled him and said, thou art his disciple. But we are Moses' disciples. We know that God spake unto Moses. As for this fellow, we know not where from whence he is. The man answered and said unto them, this is King James English. The man answered and said unto him, why herein is a marvelous thing that you know not from whence he is, and yet he has opened my eyes? Look at the blind man. The blind man had some sense. They were claiming, we are Moses' disciples. We have looked at the scriptures. But the scriptures, they missed the timing of the Messiah. They searched the scriptures. They were known as Bible scholars. They went to Bible school. They know all the books of the Bible. But they missed the timing. They missed when the Messiah was supposed to be. They were still waiting for him. He was there right there in their midst. They could touch him. They could literally touch him. He was there with them. He was there. It was their generation that would see the Messiah. But they did not know. Like a lot of people who missed the second coming. They didn't know this is the second coming. This is the generation where we're going to see Christ. This is the generation where we're going to be raptured. This is our generation. It is not another generation. It is our generation. Because the signs have already told. The signs are there. You have to be blind to miss it like the Pharisees. You have to be blind and you have to be deliberately trying to miss it, because the Pharisees, they wanted to be convinced it was not him. He said, tell us again. How did he open your eyes? And the guy said, what's wrong with you? I've already told you. They called their parents. They called his parents. Are you sure he was blind? I was like, yeah, you ask him. And then he says, this is marvelous. You guys don't know where he's from, yet he has opened my eyes. Now we know that God, this is the blind man preaching. This is his sermon. Now we know that God heareth no sinners. But if a man be a worshipper of God and doeth his will, him he heareth. Since the world began, was it not heard that any man opened the eyes of one that was born blind? Oh, what a testimony. This is the blind man saying that. If this man was not of God, he could do nothing. They answered and said to me, thou was altogether born in sins. Remember, when we go back in the beginning, Jesus said, the disciples asked him, was this man born in sin or his parents that he was born blind? And Jesus said, no, he was not. He was not. And this proves, these Pharisees had no idea what they're talking about. They said, thou altogether was born in sin. And do thou teach us? And they cast him out. So he's preaching to them, saying, what's wrong with you? This is a sign. He opened my eyes. We never, as we witnessed, a blind man's eyes were open. If he was not from God, he won't be able to do it. Jesus heard they had cast him out. And when he had found him, he said unto him, dost thou believe on the Son of God? Look at the difference now. So Jesus finally said, and meets him and said, do you believe in the Son of God? He answered and said, who is he, Lord, that I might believe on him? And Jesus said unto me, thou hast both seen him, and it is he that talketh with thee. Oh Lord, this is profound. Right there, face to face with the Messiah they read about in the books of Moses, Isaiah, Psalms. Everyone that prophesied from the prophets, oh, the Messiah is coming, the Messiah will come. And he's there. And the blind man is seeing him face to face. Because remember, when he opened his eyes, he never saw him first. He says, Jesus spat on the ground. And then he put the clay on his eyes and said, go wash. So he did not see the Messiah. So after his eyes are opened, he sees the Messiah in real life, in real time. And he said, Lord, I believe. He worshipped him. Look at the difference. For judgment I've come to this world. Look at what Jesus said. For judgment I've come to this world. That they which see not might see. And they which see might be. This is King James. For judgment have come into the world, that they which see not might see, and that they which see might be made blind. So, let me keep on reading that. It's important. And some of the Pharisees, which were with him, heard these words and said unto him, are we blind also? They were saying, are you talking about us? Are we blind, Jesus? Jesus said unto them, if you were blind, you should have no sin. But now you say, we see, therefore your sin remaineth. So this is amazing. God is saying, a lot of people are blind, are deceived. They don't understand the timings of events. They just like, they think, no, let's go back to normal. Let's just, everything is just running. The world is just ticking, talking normally. But they are fearing, they're trying to be blind like the Pharisees. They think they are seeing, they think they can see, but they're blind. They don't recognize we are the last generation. We are the end time Christians. We are this generation that will see the Messiah. We will see him like we saw the blind man saw Jesus face to face. We are going to see Christ face to face. It's going to happen in our lifetime, in our generation, because the signs are so obvious. Beautiful. This leads, let's go to the next thing, because I wanted to show you that to understand this is important for you to recognize the timings and the signs for these end times. It's important. Let me show you something else. I want to read to you just something, a sign. You know, the blind man was healed. That was a sign. It was a sign for them to know, for the Pharisees, hey, this is the Christ. So right now, What we're watching, witnessing in the world, the virus, the pandemic, these are signs telling you this is the end. These are the last days. These are signs. I want to read to you an article from the New York Times. Let me read that. So let me read one of the signs. It says New NYC mandates, right? NYC mandates proof of vaccination for indoor settings. It's going to be a quick read. Let me just read it quick. New York City is mandating the proof of COVID-19 vaccination to enter certain indoor businesses, including indoor restaurants, entertainment venues, gyms. Mayor Bill de Blasio announced on Tuesday, it is time for people to see vaccination as necessary. Look at keywords. As necessary to living a good and full and healthy life, de Blasio said during his daily press briefing. This is crucial because we know that this will encourage a lot of more vaccination. So they're trying in a roundabout way to force people to get vaccinated, because if you don't have the vaccination, you can't go and eat, you can't go to businesses. The program, which de Blasio dubbed the key to New York pass, makes New York the first major U.S. city to create such a mandate and marks a significant escalation, these are keywords, of the city's effort to curb the recent uptick in COVID-19 cases driven by the Delta variant. The initiative will be launched on August 16th, the mayor said, right? Let me read there. It will require vaccination for workers and customers in indoor dining, in indoor fitness facilities, in indoor entertainment facilities, he said from City Hall. The only way to patronize these businesses indoors is if you're vaccinated. What does this sound like to you? I'm gonna read to you something shocking. Hold on a second. Let's keep on reading. The only way to patronize these businesses indoors is if you're vaccinated. It says, if you want to, look at this word. If you want to participate in society fully, you got to get vaccinated, de Blasio added. Enforcement will begin on September 13th. When? Hey, you in the back of the class, what was the answer to that? September 13th. When? Why is this important? I will let you know shortly. So just write it down, write in a notebook, September 13th. Enforcement will begin on September 13th. Following a public service announcement campaign, de Blasio said entry will be denied to anyone without a shot. So you read that. It says, if you're going to stop the Delta variant, the time is now, said the mayor. This is going to make clear. You want to enjoy everything great in this summer of New York City? Go get vaccinated. They're not playing around. I told you, this is a sign. Like the blind man that Jesus opened his eyes, it was a sign for the Pharisees, but they missed the sign. They missed it. Like, no, this is not the Messiah. So a lot of people are going to be like, no, this is not the end time. This is not the mark of the beast. No, this is just because we want to keep the variant. Because, you know, when people get past, then it's healthy for everyone. They're going to miss the sign. The program is modeled after the vaccine passport programs rolled out in France and other European cities. De Blasio said the City Hall is finalizing the regulations, including if children younger than 12 years old with vaccinated passport will be allowed to dine indoors. Additionally, the mayor said the city is examining expanding the vaccination proof requirement to other indoor activities such as shopping. Note that, write it down, shopping. The specifics of this new policy will be finalized on the week of August 16th. About to say, New York will be required to show either the state ecclesia pass, the city's new vaccine pass, or the Center for Disease Control paper vaccination as proof. Anyway, let me keep on. Look at that. He says, a strong stance needs to be taken. The lawmaker added, it will be a controversial, but your stance, when we look back in history on this one, this will be a defining moment in your government. Okay? Look at all these people. Look at his t-shirt, vaccinated AF. I don't even explain what that even means, because you can just read there. People already look at him so proud with his vaccine passport out, ready to be in. He says, if you are vaccinated, a world of opportunity opens up for you. Oh, wow. let me keep, I just want to skip some points because I don't want to make it wrong. Just, He says, on Monday, the mayor hinted at the Big Apple moving toward a reality in which those who do not get vaccinated are barred from certain settings. He says New York is moving to a reality where if you're not vaccinated, move to the side. If you're vaccinated, come forward. An apartheid system. A discrimination between the vaccinated. This is what the man of God, Pastor Chris, has been telling us from day one. What's coming? These are signs. You have to be blind to miss these signs. It says more and more, there's going to be a reality where if you're vaccinated, a world of opportunity opens for you. If you're not, there's going to be more and more things you can do. De Blasio said during his virtual press briefing, where he announced the city will only hire vaccinated workers and advise all New Yorkers to wear masks indoor in public settings. I say that to say, go get vaccinated so that you can fully participate in the life of this city, because this is where things are going. They are telling you this. They are telling you this. How can you miss this? Okay. I told you to notice some few things. He said this program will come into effect September 13. Well, let's go to the book of Revelation 13. Revelation 13. Oh, wow. What do we find in Revelation 13? These people are very meticulous with their numbering and their numbers. It's not by random. They're not random. So, he says, this is the beast. If you read the context earlier, I don't want to read it because it's going to be a long read. It's about the beast and the false prophet. He says, he calls people to worship the beast. Anyway, maybe I should read that so people can understand what's coming next. So, man, it's going to be a long read. Let me start from verse 13. This is the false prophet. He doeth great wonders, so that he maketh fire come down from heaven on earth in the sight of men. He deceiveth them that dwell on the earth. He deceives them. He deceives them that dwell on the earth by means of those miracles which he had power to do in the sight of the beast. This is the Antichrist, the beast, saying to them that dwell on the earth that they should make an image to the beast. So the false prophet tells the people on the earth to make an image to the beast, which had a wound by a sword and did live. And he had power to give life unto the image of the beast, and the image of the beast should both speak, and cause that many as will now worship the image of the beast should be killed. So now worship, this is in the new world order, there will be an image that people will be forced to worship of the Antichrist. If they don't worship that image, they were killed. Verse 16 is where I'll be going. And he causes all, keyword all, we read in the mayor de Blasio thing, he's thinking about, oh yeah, we might think to extending this vaccine to 12-year-olds. It doesn't matter to them if you're a kid. It doesn't matter to them if you're young kids, if it affects them. They want everyone vaccinated. He causes all, both small and great, rich and poor. It doesn't matter if you're rich and poor, white or black. They don't care. Free or bond, to receive a mark in their right hand or in their foreheads, that no man might buy or sell, save that he had a mark or the name of the beast or the number of his name. He is wisdom. Let him that have understanding count the number of the beast, for it's the number of a man. His number is 666666. I told you these are signs. When the beast fully takes control, when the new world order is in effect, you won't be able to buy or sell unless you have his mark on your right hand or on your forehead. The vaccine is a platform for the mark of the beast. It is the foundation for where this beast system is going to start. So people think, oh yeah, the vaccine has nothing to do with the microchip. It is the beginning stages of it. I did a video on this actually about the the vaccine being the beta version of the microchip beast. If you know what beta and alpha means about when we mean software design, you really have the first rollout. It might not be the main rollout, but it is heading to their fine-tuning some things. When people release a software program, they'll start with a beta one to test it out, test the bugs out, fix the kinks, until it is finally released to the public. What we are seeing with the vaccine is a beta version of the mark of the beast, such that you can see its effects of like, oh yeah, if you want to go to New York and go to a restaurant, you need to be vaccinated. If you want to participate fully in society, you have to be vaccinated. Does it not sound similar to what we're hearing here in the New World Order? That's what I'm saying. These are all signs. For you to miss this sign and you're not understanding, you're an end time Christian. These are the last days. You are that generation that will see the rapture. You are that generation, and it depends. You either will see the rapture or you go through and witness and see the Antichrist and take part in the beast system. It's a choice you have to make. Be raptured with Christ or remain and go through the tribulation. And it is those that are not aware of what's going on. Those that are not aware. Yeah, those that are not aware of the timings are the ones that will be caught up in this system. If you're not aware of the timings, you'll be like the Pharisees that are still insisting, no, this is not the time. The Messiah will come. And they missed their opportune time. They were caught up. And that's why they went through the tribulation, the tough times. Who knew what would have... Think about it. If Israel recognized Jesus as the Messiah, what would have happened? Well, how would have God's plan changed? Well, what would have happened? God knows what would have happened if they knew this was the Christ. But they failed to recognize that. So it's like a lot of people will be left behind because they just thought the world is just going to keep on going the way it is. Like, nah, this is not the end time. They've been talking about this forever. The world is not coming to an end. We're still here. We're living life. Nothing's going. Everything's going back to normal. I just got to get vaccinated and I'll be able to fly. I will see my family. I just go on holiday. It's just an injection. It's nothing wrong. It's not a big deal. We're fine. I believe in Jesus. No, you're wrong. You're wrong. You're not recognizing the seasons. Let me show you another scripture before we wrap up. Another crucial scripture I want to show you. It's in the book of Luke. Luke chapter. I have so much to say, but I don't want to keep this video out. This video has already gone long enough. But oh man, I wanted to share with you something else deeper. But I feel like if I keep on going, people might miss that. I'm gonna have to do a separate video on that. So Luke chapter 19. Verse 41 says, this is talking about Jesus. And when he came near, he beheld the city. He saw Jerusalem and wept over it. Two times in the scriptures where we find Jesus weeping. The first time he wept was in Lazarus' grave when Lazarus died and he saw people crying. And they were like without shepherds. The Bible says Jesus wept. And the second time he wept is over Jerusalem. He wept over it. He says, if thou hadst known, even thou, at least in this thy day, the things which belong unto thy peace, but now they are hid from thy eyes. For the day shall come upon thee that thy enemy shall cast a trench about thee, and compass thee round, and keep thee in on every side. And they shall lay thee with the ground, thy children within thee, and they shall not leave in thee one stone upon the another, because thou knewest not the time of thy visitation. He says, because you didn't know I came for you, these things are going to come to you. So a lot of people will miss the rapture, because they were not aware this was the timing for it. It's like you, if you're about to fly and you don't know what time your flight is or you're not aware of it, you might miss your flight. They might be announcing it, flight XYZ heading to Tokyo, final call, and you're probably just walking around enjoying duty free. You're not even paying attention. You're just shopping. Duty free. Oh, tax everything, and you're just adding things in your bag. You're not even aware. And they say last call, calling Mr. Smith, flight XYZ to Tokyo. We're about to board. Gate's about to close. You're just like walking around. You're not even paying attention. And the flight closed. And then you go to the gate. It's like, oh yeah, is this flight? When is the flight? He's like, what are you talking about? The flight left. And you're like, oh man. And so when is the next flight? I don't know. You have to go talk to your ticket people. We don't know when the next flight is gonna be. This is sadly what's gonna happen to a lot of people. They were not aware there's gonna be a rapture of the church. And the times that's gonna happen when the church leaves are gonna be terrible times, difficult times, times of persecution and great tribulation, where you're gonna be dealing with the Antichrist, where the church will not have power over him. Those 7 or 3.5 years will be given to for the Antichrist to have power over the saints. He will dominate the saints. A lot of saints will be killed. It will be terrible times, tragic times. You need to be aware of the times and wake up and realize these are the final seconds of the last lap of the last hour, and be awakened to this reality and live as though it's the last time, because it is. When you're flying and you know you're constantly looking at the board. Oh, when is the gate opening? Did they call anyone? You are alert. You're not just mindless. You're not paying attention. You are very alert because you don't want to miss your flight. And that's why I want to urge you, if you're a Christian right there, be very aware of the timings and don't live your life like it doesn't matter. We still got time. You can live anyhow. This is the time to live for Jesus like you have never lived for him ever in your life. This is the time for you to give your life to him. If you're not born again, if you don't know Jesus as the Lord and Savior, this is the time, because it'll be very difficult to be a Christian during the tribulation period. So if you don't give your life to Christ now, when are you going to do it? So I want to pray for you first. If you're not born again, I want to pray for you. I want you to receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior and not to miss the flight when it happens. So I want you to say these words. Say, I believe in Jesus. Oh Lord God, I believe in Jesus Christ. I believe he died for me. I believe you raised him from the dead. I accept Jesus as my Lord and Savior. I receive eternal life into my spirit. I'm born again. I'm a child of God. Thank you, Lord, for saving my soul. If you said that prayer, God heard you. You're born again. You're a child of God. Welcome to the family. Now you have to live for him. You can't just live anyhow, because like I said, these are the last times. These are the last times. And you need to be alert in your spirit. You need to be alert in your spirit, doing the things that he told us to do before he comes back. Fellowshipping with other believers, praying, winning souls, listening to studying the word like you're doing right now. And that's why I want to invite you to subscribe to my newsletter. I'm having like a Bible study every Saturday, where it's going to be fellowship with other believers, studying the word of God, building our faith strong, praying together, motivating each other, encouraging. He says, encouraging each other as you see the day coming, because the time is short. And you need to be in fellowship with other believers, not in fellowship with the wrong people. No, you need to be in the right company. So I'll put the link in the description, in the comment section. Click that link, join the newsletter. I'll send you a newsletter every Sunday. And also, I'll send you a link to a Zoom Bible study every Saturday at 8 p.m. GMT. It's going to bless you tremendously. So make sure you do that. You don't want to miss this. If you're new to the channel, make sure you subscribe to this channel. And I want you to put in the comment section, I'm going to be on the fast flight. Put in the comment section, I'm on the fast flight. This is important. Put in the comment section, I want you to put that. You know, confess that. Be alert. These are the last times. I want to share another video. I wanted to put it in this video, but it seems it's going to be long. But this was an important revelation our man of God, Pastor Chris, revealed during your love word. And I want to do a separate video. Probably it's going to be a part two to this, about the seventh kingdom. We are literally going to witness the emergence of the seventh kingdom. For those that know what I'm talking about, you know what I'm talking about. But this is the hour of the seventh kingdom. Wow. Oh, Lord, so much to say, so little time. But I appreciate each and every one of you. Thank you once again for watching. Make sure you subscribe. Make sure you go join the newsletter. Be part of this family. Be part of the Bible study. and we're gonna grow, we're gonna get ready for the coming of Christ. We're not gonna lose it, we're not gonna miss it. We'll catch that fast flight in Jesus' mighty name. Until next time, it's been your boy Mundus. Be victorious and prosperous in all you do. God bless you.